Okay, let's do one thing. It's raining, as you can see. So let's get our umbrellas on, and you know, we'll carry forward the discussion. Ridham, if you could. Okay. So Ridham, we were discussing.
So first thing, I'm keeping this umbrella. Okay.
Okay. Even I don't have one actually. So.
So but this is my gift from you.
But this year it's been different, right? I mean, at least this year the monsoon is. It looks like it's well on its way to. We are well on our way to have a decent monsoon this year. At least it looks like that.
In December. I moved aggressively on rural stocks. And the reason was because, so one of the outcomes of having listened to Red Tide was I became a big follower of climate change. Okay. So see how things connect up, right? And I have been a follower of climate change, and I've been reading about climate change. And I've been reading about the factors that drive the southwest monsoon. And it was way back in December that it became kind of not apparent, but the possibility that we may actually get a good monsoon.
So this so reading and all, it helps in stock market. So you can't say that you're not sure.
No, it certainly helps. Hmm. No, of course it helps. And I think the guru of this is Charlie Munger.
Okay.
Who says that to win in the stock markets, you need a multidisciplinary approach. You need to have knowledge about varying subjects, from psychology to physics. And I think that's of great, this is a great illustration of the multidisciplinary approach that Charlie Munger, who's, you know, for those who don't know, Warren Buffett's famous or less famous partner,
okay,
has always espoused.
Let's just complete that point on music. Bollywood music, what's been your favorite?
So I think Kishore Kumar certainly stands out as both my wife and my favorite singer. I mean, he's outstanding, except that I prefer his 50s and 60s. She prefers the 70s and 80s. I think he mellowed down and became a more soulful singer, whereas he was a more frolicking, fun singer in the 50s and 60s. So, but I think he was just outstanding. And... you know, right now the one that I'm listening to, which I'll be listening to today when I go for a run, is the Satte Pe Satta song.
Pyar hai mere kis mood pe le aaya.
I love that song.
Now you listen to this song very often.
Yeah, I listen, as I said, music, you know, all types of music fascinate me. Music fascinates me.
Okay.
Maybe it's something to do with my name, but it fascinates me.
Yes. Yes, rhythm in your name. So
yeah. I regret not having learned a musical instrument.
Okay.
And maybe someday I will.
Which one do you want to really play? Guitar?
I think guitar will be the probably the easiest one, but frankly,
keyboard?
I have no idea. Keyboard maybe,
yes.
I don't know.
Ridham, let's talk about the other big passion of your life. You are a voracious reader, and you know, this brings me to the Morgan Stanley summit that you had, and after that fun closing bell that we had a 1 hour discussion on books. And you have classified your books into 4 categories. You want to take us through that and how that's impacted your own investment decision?
So I think people get intimidated about reading.
Okay.
And that is why I think we should not intimidate people. Even I was intimidated by reading, and I was not a natural reader. I didn't like to read. I read only to the extent to what was required. But going beyond that, again, requires a bit of a push. And I think there is one push that I can give the viewers of this show, which is that you can make money out of reading.
Okay.
So maybe that's an interesting thing. So, you know, as you said, so how do you make money out of reading? So I think if you want to make money, then you categorize your reading into 4 compartments.
Okay.
The first one is the obvious one, which is read about investing.
Okay.
The challenge here is that reading about investing will not make money for you. Okay, it'll just make you appear smarter to the rest of the world. Okay, it's not actually going to make you money.
Okay.
Making money requires other type of reading. Like, you need to read about climate change if you have to make money and anticipate the rains, not about investing. There are 2 books that I would recommend that people read simultaneously or back to back to understand this statement, which is read Value Investing by Benjamin Graham, and then read Common Stocks, Uncommon Profits by Philip Fisher.
Okay.
They are completely contrasting books, which suggest totally opposite approaches to portfolio management. So Graham, as everybody knows, Warren Buffett's guru and professor, is a value investor, believes in buying stocks that are trading below fair value, deep below fair value with a huge margin of safety. Phil Fisher, on the other hand, who was a very successful investor, arguably one of the most successful investors of the last century, invested only in growth stocks.
Okay.
And he pays lip service to valuations.
Okay.
And his point on valuations, yeah, if it feels like it is trading too rich, then you may want to avoid it. But don't get scared by a multiple on a stock, because invariably, for a growth stock, the growth is not fully priced in. And there's always money to be made. And don't get frightened by a 30-40% fall in the price of a growth stock, because that's an opportunity to buy. Totally contrasted with Benjamin Graham. So when you read these two books, you'll realize that whatever you know about investing is wrong. Or right, as the case may be.
Your approach is in between, right? Growth at a reasonable price.
No, see, my approach, from a professional standpoint, I have to recommend to my institutional clients who generally have a 12 to 18 month time horizon. They don't have the time horizon of Benjamin Graham and Philip Fisher.
Yes.
And I think that's what's happened to the current investing environment, which is that stocks are long duration assets. You have to own them really long term.
Yes.
In order to extract returns from them.
Yes.
And when I say long term, I think the minimum investing period is 10 years.
10 years?
Yeah. But your channel will shut down if you talk about only 10-year investing, and a lot of professional mandates out there will not work out. Because people want results faster.
Yes.
I would recommend that people buy stocks for 15, 20, 30 years and just not worry about them on a day-to-day basis. But that is from a personal perspective. From a professional perspective, I have to watch for the rains. I have to watch for cycles in investing, because the market moves from value to growth to value.
Yes.
It moves from quality to junk to quality.
Yes.
We know that in the long run, quality works the best. We know in the long run that reasonably priced growth stocks work the best. But you know, there will be periods, and fairly protracted periods in the market, when they will not work.
Yes.
And if you are a professional in this industry, that's enough for you not to have a job.
Okay.
So you have to be realistic about.
I think you have been very candid about this, Ridham. So that's financial investing books. What else?
So that's one category which will not help you make money, but will help you understand how people invest.
Yes.
And maybe you can decide based on your temperament what philosophy you want to follow.
Yes.
See, value investing requires a very, very deep degree of patience. You have to wait on the sidelines forever for value to emerge. And then you may have to wait on the sidelines for a long time for that value to be captured into the share price. So temperaments are different for different types of styles. The second category, I think, is history.
Okay.
I think people underestimate the power of history in investing. And I'll tell you the comparative advantage. You started at the outset, you know, talking about success. I think one of the factors which I would put my success down to is that I came into this market in the mid-80s. I have 31 years of Sensex chart in my head. And I tell you, that is such a big and unfair comparative advantage I have over all my sell-side competition who have not been in the markets that long. And for them to live through that entire 30 years is not possible. You can read as many books as you want, but I have lived through those 30 years, so I have very good memories of the IPO boom of the mid 80s, of the crisis that we had in the late 80s and early 90s, of the reforms that happened. And I can, you know, at some point tell you all the stories about how you know, how things changed. I remember from, and we'll digress a bit, but in 92, so this was just before the market peaked out, March of 92, when the finance minister was delivering his budget, and he said something about the cement sector, and there were 50 or 60 people crouching on a glass table at my then broker's office. Okay. So there's a glass table, pretty big in size, and 60 people crouching on it, okay? And there was a lot of excitement, stocks were up a lot, and suddenly the table broke, okay? It broke, it crashed. And imagine the broker's reaction was, what was the last stock that was mentioned on this table? So somebody said XYZ. He picks up the phone, calls his jobber and says, go and buy 5 lakh shares of that. because this is a very good omen. Glass is broken. So I've lived through that type of bull market. In fact, I keep telling people that that bull market never came back.
Okay.
The 2003-2008 bull market is pale in front of the 91-92.
Oh, wow.
In that period of 9 months, the Sensex went up fivefold, five times.
In 9 months.
In 9 months.
Yes.
There were stocks which went up 100 times in 9 months.
Okay.
So that type of a bull run we didn't see. So I think history plays a very important role. And reading about history, I think, is crucial. Crucial to understanding even today's... I attend a lot of events and interact with a lot of people who... And in fact, even in our investor summit, where a lot of opinions were expressed about the technology disruption that the world is going through and how that's going to disorient existing businesses and how scared you should be about buying traditional business models that are not aware of these technology disruptions. If you are a student of history, you will know that at every moment of time in the last 500 years, we have had a technology disruption. Mm. And there's nothing unique about this technology disruption compared to the horse carriages of New York City in the late 1800s when Ford was going to put his car into the marketplace, or the changes that happened in the 50s and 60s when America got its telephone and television revolution. We've had successive periods of technology change. So I think history is very important to understanding the context of current changes and how relevant they are.
Yes.
The third category, I think, is maths and science.
Yes.
That will be less appreciated by your audience. Why would you want to learn math and science? But I think math has got a huge amount of connectivity with the stock markets. Mm. I'm not going to delve in details, but just one simple thing. So the biggest success formula in the market is compounding. Mm. Right? So Charlie Munger says that the secret of making money is compounding.
Yes.
If you compound at 10% a year, what you will have at the end of 10 years is remarkably big compared to what if you just receive 10% returns every year.
Yes.
Compounding is a concept that comes from maths, not from finance. Mm. And it comes in Euler's formula, which is e raised to I pi plus 1 is equal to 0. It's a magical formula. But forget about that formula. Just think about e, which is the base to the natural logarithm. Mm. And replace I and pi. I is imaginary number, but replace I and pi with R and T. R is your rate of interest and time is the time for which you earn that interest.
Yes.
With that formula, you can calculate the compounded gains on any principal amount in an instant.
Wow.
It comes from math. It doesn't come from financing.
Yes.
And likewise with science. I think the world of physics and biology. In fact, on science, I've written an essay that the stock market doesn't resemble physics and math at all. Physics and math are governed by laws. Actually, physics is governed by laws. Math is abstract. Is governed by laws. So at every point in time, you will feel gravity. There will be no violation of that law at the gross level. It resembles more closely biology or medicine, to be more precise.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And medicine is essentially, there are some universal principles, but every patient is unique. And every patient has to be treated in an idiosyncratic fashion by the doctor looking at him. You cannot put medicine into a algorithm. And that is exactly what the market is. You can't put the market into an algorithm. Of course, a lot of people in the tech world have told me I'm totally wrong.
There are
but every stock, every stock requires idiosyncratic application of your knowledge and skills. And what works for one stock doesn't work for another.
Mm.
It's like medicine. So I think the markets are like medicine. There's a lot to learn from the medicine world and to be applied to stock markets.
Okay. And the last one?
The last is, I think, psychology.
Yes.
It's the most important one. Because I think dealing with the market, and I think this is a very, it's a very mundane and very well rehearsed phrase. You have to deal with fear and greed.
Yes.
But I think there are two more emotions you have to deal with.
Okay.
Which is envy and boredom.
Okay.
So most of the mistakes people make is out of the envy that the other guy made so much money and you end up making mistakes. Yeah. And most of the action that we take in the market comes out of boredom.
Yes.
So because you're so bored, you trade. So that trading is very expensive. It's very expensive. And it costs you all the returns in the world. And envy is also very expensive. In fact, I think these two human emotions are more crucial than fear and greed.
So what's the best book? book on psychology that you have read?
So I think I don't know best book, but the two books that stand out to me, one is Thinking Fast and Slow by the guru, the master Danny Kahneman, who won a Nobel Prize for his work, pioneering work in the area of psychology. It's a very hard book to read. It's very detailed, it's very big. But if you want to learn it in the stock market context, then there is nobody better than Charlie Munger. And Charlie, unfortunately for us, all of us, has not written a book. But somebody has gone and written a book on Charlie Munger, and it's called The Almanac, The Poor Charlie Munger's Almanac, The Wit and Wisdom of Charles T. Munger. It's a coffee table book. The last chapter of that book deals with human misjudgment and psychology. And you may not want to read the rest of it, but just read the last 20 pages. It's an incredible amount of insight into human psychology.
Okay. Ritham, I know, you know, we can go on and on, but we are, you know, we have paucity of time. So we'll keep interacting for our audience as well. Of course, I hope to keep interacting with you, Ritham, you know, on a personal basis through the life. It was a pleasure doing this show with you. Thanks a lot for being such a gracious host.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ritham. Thank you.